Hi, I'm Deboki, and this is Okidoki Boki, and today I am really excited to be talking about a really cool thing, which is that I am hosting Crash Course Organic Chemistry. I'll link to Crash Course down below, so you can check out the Organic Chemistry series if you want, but they also have a lot of other awesome educational content. There's a lot I could say about why I'm excited to be part of the Crash Course team in general for this, just like in terms of getting to work with all of these people who are so awesome and so good at what they do, and are especially so good at like making this really complicated topic accessible. Getting to see how like the people who structure and write and like illustrate everything are like working through all of that is really, really cool. And I feel really lucky that I get to be any part of this process at all. But with that said, I'm gonna be a little bit self-centered today because like I feel like I would have been excited to be part of any Crash Course team, but it's especially meaningful to me that I'm hosting organic chemistry in particular, and so I just wanted to talk about that. I feel like I have like a weirdly high number of organic chemistry related anecdotes for someone who's actually not a chemist. They're not necessarily good stories, but that's never stopped me before from telling them, so like why would I stop now? I took organic chemistry as an undergrad, and one of my like most vivid memories of Orgo was this time when my roommates and I were like on the way to class. So there's no one around, right? Because it's the morning. There's like nothing going on really except everyone who has to walk to Orgo. There's no one at this intersection at us until this car comes up and just starts blasting Sandstorm. And it was really cool because like it was like, well, like I guess we're gonna get hyped for class now. But it was weird to just like in the middle of the street, just like with nothing else going on, just only hear like do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. I feel like it's the kind of thing that only happens when you're on the way to organic chemistry. Oh, there was another time that year where I think I was like getting ready for a quiz or whatever. There's always a quiz, right? And I just have this like really strong memory of this one dream. It's like the dream that I remember more than any other dream that I've had, which was this dream where I was a carbon molecule. And in the dream, as this carbon molecule, I really wanted to lose my hydrogen. So I like got up in the middle of the night and then I took off my sweatpants because in my head, the sweatpants represented hydrogen. And then I went back to sleep. And then later I was like, hey, you know, like I'm a carbon molecule, I want my hydrogen back. So I woke up again and I put my sweatpants back on. Oh, then there was another time. So I went to a nerd camp when I was in high school. And then when I was in college, they did this contest where you could like write an essay about what nerd camp meant to you. And I was one of the winners for this. And so that meant that I got to go to this event for Nobel Prize winners. But the event was about an hour away from the campus, and so I didn't know how to get there because I didn't have a car. But I was crafty. I was like, you know who's really smart are the Nobel Prize winning professors on our campus, and some of them are on this guest list. And so I didn't know any of them, but I emailed them and was just like, hey, I'm this undergrad. Can you give me a ride to that thing where they're celebrating you? And one of the professors actually said yes. His name is Professor Robert Grubbs. He's an organic chemist. He won the Nobel Prize in 2005. He and his wife took me in their car to the Getty, and I got to hang out with him and other really smart Nobel Prize winners, and it was really cool. They were really nice, and I learned that if you win the Nobel Prize, you get to have wonderful dinners at the Getty. I have taken a lot of science classes in my life, and I am not a chemist, but for some reason, organic chemistry is the one science that seems to be making the most like recurring appearances in my stories. And like that is weird to me, except that I'm also like starting to become increasingly convinced that organic chemistry, just like the entire field, is like a family curse slash blessing of sorts. And to explain that, I'm gonna need to explain my family. So to start, let me tell you about my wedding. At this wedding reception where all of our friends, our families, they were gathered there that day, you know, for food and drinks and also for the wedding, but mostly for the food and drinks. To kick off the toast, my dad stood up in front of all of our guests and gave them a brief lecture about energy trophic levels. It was really important to him, you see, because my husband is vegan, and my dad really wanted everyone in the room to understand like the connections between dietary choices and the environment, and like how energy gets passed up and down and whatever through ecosystems and whatever, all of this stuff. He wanted our guests to understand it. And for some of our guests, this was a new experience. For many of them, it was not, because my dad tells stories about what he knows, and what he knows is science. To sit down for anything with my dad is to sit down for an anthology. The stories are tied together, sometimes through the loosest of narrative threads, until he's taken you on a full journey that can, and often has included the discovery of the smallpox vaccine, the use of paper to measure the atomic bomb blast, and that time that he got caught setting off fireworks because he forgot that sulfur is heavier than air. Fortunately, it turns out that there is a job for people who enjoy talking about science to a captive audience with little regard for time constraints. My dad is a chemistry professor, and my mom is too. They are the first scientists I ever knew. My dad's abilities and interests weren't developed spontaneously. He was also born to two chemists, who I called Didu and Dadu, who lived on the other side of the world in the city of Kolkata in India. My grandfather Dadu didn't tell stories so much as he had stories told about him. I didn't know about the time that he chased down an escaped pet peacock until my dad told me that story. I also didn't know until an uncle told me that Dadu's work with the organic chemist Sir Robert Robinson on the structure of strychnine would end up contributing to Robinson's Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1947. The only story that I actually remember Dadu telling me was about this time he took a boat to visit the US to visit various academic institutions, and the kids on the boat were like so fascinated by this quiet Indian man that they would just like throw candies through his like door through the keyhole. Dadu pretty much refused to retire. Like even in his 90s, he was still going to work, he was still studying chemical reactions, but he passed away the summer after I graduated from high school. That summer, I only had to learn of Dadu's death once, but my grandmother, who I called Didu, had been bedridden for more than a decade, and that compounded issues that she had with dementia and Alzheimer's. When we went to Kolkata that summer, Didu would ask for him every few minutes, then later every few hours, then later every few days, until eventually she no longer mentioned him at all. To me, as this young girl who was growing up on stories of my grandparents along with what I knew when I would go to visit them, Dadu was steady like the house that they lived in, but Didu was frenetic like the city around them, or at least that's what I was told. Always when my mom conjures up the vision of the Didu that she knew best, it's of this woman in an impeccably styled sari and a matching purse, zipping around the city, taking all the buses, just going everywhere, knowing everyone like she owns the place. And Didu is like every bit as legendary in my family as Dadu was. She had been the head of the chemistry department at Bethune College, a women's college at the University of Calcutta. And growing up, it felt like I was always meeting her former students. Even my mom used to be one of her students before she later became her daughter-in-law. And I grew up with all of these amazing stories about her energy, her generosity, her determination, just like how much she loved her work, how much she loved teaching. Probably most legendary of all were probably the stories of her PhD, which she did in Oxford in the 40s as an unmarried woman. Like she was like traveling alone to another country. And like at that time, that was still a striking thing. And Didu was so determined to finish her work quickly. Like she was like, I'm here, this is cool. You're letting me work in this lab and stuff, but I also want to go home, you know? So she decided to finish her PhD in 1.5 years, which fucking ridiculous to me. It took me 7 years to finish my PhD. But the stories that I heard of Didu were a sharp contrast to the woman I grew up with, the woman who was bedridden and whose memory was ultimately fading. When her mind was still active, Didu would tell me the stories about her younger days. She told me about games she played when she was younger. She told me about school. She told me about this time that she went to a conference and she lost my dad. I think they were in Japan, but she found him because he was wearing this hat. It was like a whole thing. But over time, as her memory faded, the number of stories she could tell grew smaller and smaller until she returned to only one, the story of her Oxford days. Even with like this distance in time and the haze of dementia, the thing that stuck with her were the British guys that she worked with, like this mass of nameless admirers who like were either asking her for help, begging her for help, or being sent to her for help. And when they weren't asking her for help, they were repaying the favor by like following her around the lab to try to like make sure that her sari wouldn't catch on any Bunsen burners and like get lit and, you know, go on fire. And like whenever she told me about that part, she would laugh so much because it was like, to her, like even like decades later, she's like, you know, like, I know how to use my sari, I know how to do chemistry, like I've been doing this all day, I'm not gonna catch on fire, I know what I'm doing, right? Like it was so amusing to her that like they would be so worried about this thing that to her she was like, eh, like I got it, I know how to do this. And so full disclosure, the bulk of what I'm telling you right now actually comes from an essay that I wrote like 3 or 4 years ago for an application for a media fellowship that I was hoping would help me transition out of like grad school when I graduated and into like, you know, some kind of writing career. And at that time, as I was writing that essay, I was really struck by this idea that, like, you know, I was the same age as she was, like, in that story. I was in the same point in my life. And so while I was writing it, I was just, like, really hung up on this idea that that period in my life could be, you know, like it had been for my grandmother, could be the last story that I ever knew, that I ever told. And I was just so scared of like what my life was gonna be at that point, that it was really hard to imagine that that could be the case, that like decades later, I would like look back on that era fondly. But puzzling through what her experience must have been, like kind of emphasized something to me, which is that like these stories aren't static. Like what it is when you experience it changes over time. The way that I thought about it with her is like when she was younger, like that time at Oxford, maybe she was scared, maybe she was stressed, like she was working really hard. But it was also probably like this funny anecdote. Eventually that story probably took a back seat because when she like had to run a department, when she had to run a household. And you know, for a long time it was a story I didn't hear as much of. And it wasn't really until the end of her life that I started to hear that story more. And maybe the reason why this story endured and the reason why she started telling it again was because it brought back this point in her life where she was doing something that she really loved, that she was really passionate about, and at the same time involved these characters basically whose names didn't bring about sadness when forgotten. And maybe the reason she was telling me this story was the same reason that Dadu was telling me his one story about visiting the country that would decades later become the place that I was born, because it was this thing that across time and place connected us. Part of my fear, like over the past decade, as I've like figured out what I want to study and later what I want to do for work and like all this stuff, was like this realization that I wasn't going to continue with what my family knows best, which is organic chemistry and research. I wasn't going to be able to rely on their experience anymore. And even though that's like a thing that obviously a lot of people do, that was the first time that I was fully confronting it like a few years ago, and it's been scary. The fellowship that I applied for with this essay, like when I applied for it, I remember thinking of it as like this like shining beacon of just like opportunity, where it was like, if you get this, like you can do it. Like you will get to the next step. You have figured something out and you will be able to get to where you want to be. And then I got rejected. I didn't get the fellowship, and it was terrifying. Like I was like, oh fuck, like shit, like this is the only path that I can currently understand for getting where I want to be, and now I'm not gonna be able to get that path going. Like how do I do this? Like how do I get to that place where like I can do what I want to do, which is to write and talk and create things that like are related to science? And so the thing is, like, I was wrong. Like it turns out that fellowship was not the only opportunity out there. And so like that's like a big part of like why, on a very selfish level, I'm excited for Crash Course, because it feels good that like I get to do this thing that is really cool and that's in line with the things that I've been wanting to do. But also, when I told my parents that I was going to be hosting Crash Course Organic Chemistry, they both immediately had the same reaction, which is that Didu would have been so happy. She loved organic chemistry, she loved teaching, but also like I think like if YouTube had existed decades ago, if Crash Course had existed decades ago, she would be doing this. She would have just like set up a camera and she would have taken you through how to do a chemistry experiment without setting your shardy on fire. And so that's a big part of why I'm excited for organic chemistry in particular. I'm really excited to talk about all of this cool science that like shapes how our world works. I'm really excited for people to get to learn about organic chemistry to hopefully better understand it, whether it's for their own course material or for their own curiosity. I'm really excited for all the people that I get to work with, but most of all, I'm excited for my family. I miss my grandparents, and I miss the conversations we had. I miss the conversations we didn't get to have. And I like that this is a part of my conversation now with my parents, that this is part of the story that we tell each other. And you know, traditions and heirlooms, those are things that we hand down from generation to generation. And there are these things that connect us, you know, with people that we knew, people we didn't know, but they're like this ongoing conversation that you have across your family, across generations, even when you don't get to have those conversations anymore. And our family has those, but we're also a bunch of nerds, so apparently we hand down organic chemistry too.